We have started our course last week with a mild introduction, followed by a set of motivational examples. I have also started my crash course on C++, which covered the basics. And today I will continue from where we left off, which is around slide 50, I guess. Yeah, okay, we come here, and so we were in this overloading business, and I will resume from here. So we have function overloading as well as operator overloading. Function overloading is something you have already experienced with if you are if you have programmed in C, for instance. It's a quite regular and well-known concept. Basically, you have the file with the same name, but they differ by the input parameter types. Okay, it is the idea actually. Here I have a random number generator functions, a set of them. The first two are overloaded, so I have function overloading here because they have the same name of rando I for random integer. First one returns a random integer between a and b using its two parameters a and b, and the second one just returns an integer between 0 and b, so they behave a little bit differently. And this guy has nothing to do with the above. It is not overloading because it has a different name, randof, for floating point numbers. And so in the execution, since I am providing an integer here to this square function, this one will get executed, the integer version, and here the real number version, the double version, will get executed. And so if I have used 7.0, for instance, here, then again the double version will get executed because 7.0 is not an integer. Yes, so that is that actually, nothing special there. Now the special parts, the new part for C++ is this operator overloading business, where I assign new meanings, new but still semantically meaningful meanings to the operators. They can be binary operators like the addition, which expects two operands, two binary, and we also have unary operators in C++, such as what? such as the increment operator, right? Plus plus. When you put it in front of x, x increases by one. So this is unary operator. It expects only one operand, either to the left or right. Okay, so we have operators. Now I will assign new meanings to them. For instance, the multiplication operator, the asterisk. Normally, it is defined to multiply numbers, floats, doubles, integers. But it is not defined to multiply complex numbers. Okay. Or for addition, you can't add vectors normally, but I can overload addition and make it work for vector class as well. So the way we do this is as follows. I need to define a function in which I overload the operator. Okay, so let me go through an example with that. Here in my complex class, I want to support this action, multiplication action. So basically a complex number C1 times C2. I want to execute this, and obviously for some reason to assign the result to another complex number like C3. Normally when you do it like this, it will give you a compiler error because compiler sees the operator, it looks to the left operand and right operand, right hand side. It expects a number, but now it sees an object from a class that he doesn't know. So it is a compiler error. But thanks to this function, I will overload this multiplication operator for the complex class. And since C1 and C2 are objects of complex class, we are good. So how do I do this? Basically, the operator sees this statement as follows. C1, the left operand, calls dot, recall that for accessing the members of this object, calls this special function this name operator star, so I will not write all of them. Op star is okay. And then the parameter comes, which is the right hand side, so in this case C2. So now everything looks compilable to us, right? I have a function like this, it expects a parameter which is here, so it is good. So how to implement this then? Before going there, let's do some calculus nostalgia. What's the complex number? So C1 points to this complex number, which is a plus bi, where a is the real part and b is the imaginary part. Okay, and so C1 has real part equal to a and imaginary part equal to b. So let's remember the complex class. It has two data members, real and imaginary. Okay, so C1 dot re is a, C1 dot im is b. Similarly, C2 looks like this, c plus di, where d is the imaginary part, and I square is equal to minus 1. This is the calculus we need to remember. Then the resulting is, what is the real part? AC minus BD, right? Because BD is multiplied by I square, so minus BD would be my my real part of this C3, so of the newcomer, whatever the name is. Plus, I also need an imaginary part, which is what? Which is what? AD plus BC. AD plus BC. I don't have a mouse, even I am using a trackpad, so that's why the weird writing tempo and quality here. Okay, so let's implement this function then. I have the implementation here luckily, so this is that function. So recall, C1 calls this, so when you see a naked RE on its own, it is C1.RE, which is in this case A, right? And right hand side C2 lands here, right hand side. So what is the real part of C2? It is C. So AC, I get my AC. Similarly, imaginary of C1, the color is B times imaginary of this is D. AC minus BD, which is what I want. Wonderful. So I got this part already. And this is the real part of the newcomer that I call product or prod. So prod.re is this. Similarly, I set prod.im and then I return this new complex number to the color, which is here, and C3 catches it. So C3 is that product now, which is AC minus BD plus AD plus BCI. Yeah, that is the whole story actually. It is the end of it. This logic applies to all operator overloading business. Let's do another overloading then. I want to support this action. I want to say C1 times a scalar, which is 8 maybe. Then what happens is the result will be what? So let's do the generic version. C1 times the scalar k. So this is a k. What do you expect? C1, recall this is a plus bi. So I have ak as the real guy, real part, plus bki. And bk is the imaginary part. So how do I obtain this? I have a operator overloaded. So this is also a function overloaded, by the way. The same function name with different parameters, right? Here the parameter is this k, a floating number. So when it lands here, again the naked re belongs to c1, which is a, and I have ak. Similarly, I have bk here, and I return it back. So let's see that action with the driver program for a more formal teaching here. So I have C1 is an object of class complex, and it calls the default constructor with zero parameters, because here, so you don't write the parentheses, it's the default constructor. So if you recall that class definition. Default constructor here is no parameter, so I set these values, which are the default values, 0. So they will all be 0, 0. Let's come back. So C1 is 0 plus 0i. Very useless complex number. C1 is another object representing the complex number 1 plus 0i. And C3 is another complex number representing the object. C3 is another object representing the complex number 1 plus 2i. Yeah, so with that in mind, I do this multiplication from right to left. So C3 times C2 returns a complex number called product, prod. Okay, it comes here as a new complex number, let's call it C4. Then it gets multiplied by your C2, which gives yet another complex number, and it suddenly, it finally becomes C1. So see, I can concatenate my operators as well, thanks to this return here. Similarly, we have studied this, C1 can be multiplied by a scalar value, then it gets translated into that by compiler C1 dot operator star 5. How about this? So this doesn't look healthy to me, because if you do this tactic again, it five calls operator star with the parameter C1. And here is the problem. 5 is just a plain and simple integer, so it doesn't have a function inside of it like this. You can do 5 dot a function, because 5 is a built-in integer. So this is an error. But we can still do this. How can I solve this problem? So if you are obsessed about doing this, because it's in calculus, we can. These are commutative operations. C1 times 5 is equal to 5 times C1. So if you really want to do this here as well, what you can do is you can define this function outside the scope of the complex class. So be careful, so far all of them are inside the complex class. Now you need to put it out somewhere outside, and then you try to do the following. You try to use the RE, but there is a problem, immediate problem. This is in the outside of the class scope, and RE, IM, these stuff are private, guys. Recall again my throwback. These are private, so you cannot access from outside. So there will be a compiler error here. What you can do is, inside our complex class, and finally I copy-pasted it here to prevent going back. Inside this class, I can provide public functions that return real number or imaginary number. So I can use them now. I also have the set version of them to update them. So with that in mind, now outside the class I can do c.getReal with no problem. Another solution to this private issue is the usage of friends keyword. What's a friend function? So this function will be declared, implemented outside of this class. But within this class I declare it as my friend. So what it gives you is, since complex declares it as its friend, then this function can access its private members, even if it is outside this class scope. Okay, that is about friendship. So since it is defined as friend, now it can access the private parts. So let me talk more on this friendship issue. I have a class A, class and class B. Class B announces that A is my friend. So what does this give to A? A can now access the private parts of B, but not vice versa. Since A hasn't announced a friendship about B, B cannot access the private parts of A. Okay, so they are not friends. So then comes an irrelevant transition here to some very toy examples, like printing first 5 first four integers or first even first five even numbers, I guess, right? Here I see the while loop that iterates log 24 times because I divide them by 2 all the time. Anyway, so that was quite irrelevant. I don't know why I have used them. So pointers, let's come to a totally different topic with a nice demo that has some jokes in it which don't land in my opinion, but still I can
Hey Binky, wake up. It's time for pointer fun. What's that? Learn about.
Maybe we should cut the voice. So this is x is a pointer to an integer, okay? Similarly, y is a pointer to an integer. So these are currently pointers to integers, but no integers are around yet. So you make them around by using this statement, new int. So recall int. So x is a pointer to an integer. And now I allocate a new memory for an integer. So this int and this int, they should match. They must match. And basically, this is the equivalent of the malloc stuff in C. Int x equal to malloc. Give me size of integer, one integer. If you want more of them, you can multiply it here. And then you also need to cast it back to integer, right? So it was something like that. So instead of this ugly statement, I can just do one new int, okay, in C++. Okay, so this is my new int. Now, new memory that is capable of holding one integer is reserved to me. Now I dereference. This is called dereferencing. So what I do is basically star x. So this becomes one as a package. What is in the left? Int is in the left. So now I can do with an integer, like I can set it to 42. Then this location is filled with the number 42, as we can see in this weird animation. Then what they do is they try to dereference a pointer that has not allocated any spaces yet. Then there will be an error. So this is a mistake. There is y. Okay, it is declared, but there wasn't any new on that y. So we have this weird effect. Again, a joke that doesn't land. What you can do instead is you can tell that y is a pointer to an integer and x is also a pointer to an integer. So y can point to wherever x is already pointing to. So this is valid. You can do this, no compile error. But now there is this side effect issue. When you now dereference y, which you can do, and set it to 13, now this place becomes 13, and when x tries to read it, it will read 13. Okay, so maybe you do this on purpose, but you should be aware of this fact. Okay, so these are the tricky parts of pointer business. Yes, now let's also describe the same thing with my slides. I have count variable which is equal to 7, so a memory with 7 in it is reserved to you. Now the count pointer is a pointer to an integer. So this is just count pointer is a pointer to an integer, so it's an address. So I can set it to the address of an integer variable, which happens to be count here. So count pointer is pointing to the address where the 7 lives. Okay, that is the idea. Yeah, my pointer is a pointer to an integer. And by the way, you can stick this asterisk sign to the type. Personally, I do it that way. More meaningful for me, but this is also popular. You can also leave it alone with spaces in left and right, etc. So, how do I get the address? Y is a variable, 5, integer variable. Y pointer points to an integer. Okay, so far we get this. Now, y pointer itself has the address of y. So this statement makes this arrow. And visually what's happening is when you say y equal to 5, operating system gives you a random address, God knows where, and inside of which you put 5. Okay. Then when you declare this, operating system gives you another random location for this variable. Again, random. But inside of it, I want to put the address of y, which is 600,000. So these are not by chance. Okay, dereferencing, also known as indirectioning, indirecting, but dereferencing is more popular, is to get the type out of that integer. So recall, it was int y pointer. So when you keep it as 1, 2 becomes 1. What is on the left is the type int. So in this case, 7. Whatever y pointer is pointing that address, I will put number 7 in inside of it. Another example, rate is created here at address 1008. And since it's an integer, I expect 4 bytes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 32 bits. Then I put number 500 in it, okay. I declare p underscore rate at a totally random location, address 1000. And now I want it to hold the address of rate, which is 1008. So again, this is not coincidence. It is that number. I have integers a and b, as well as a pointer to an integer called p. A is 7, b is 7. Now, so a is 7 here and b is 7 here. Now p gets the address of a, so p points here. So when I print dereference p, it will print 7. It was here anyway. 7 for a, 7 for b. So this prints 7. When I change that thing, this doesn't get hurt, but this becomes 3, which is a. So a prints 3. Now p changes the address that it points to. So it wants to point here now, which it can do because p is not a constant pointer. If I have declared it like this, p is a pointer to an integer, but p can also be a constant pointer to an integer, then you are not allowed to change p. But this is not the case here, so you can forget about this. Now p is pointing to where p address is. So when I dereference, I get the value of b, which is 7. 2 times 7 is 14, minus a is 3. I get 11. And that 11 is written to where p is pointing, so this becomes 11. And when you print b, it will print 11. Let's do parameter passing methods, which connects to pointers at some point. So I have a function called set 0. So here I am in a different scope, in a different function. I have a variable x equal to 7. When I call this function regularly, it is called call by value, x is 7. A copy of x is made. So I have 7 here for x, and here a copy of x is made, another memory location. And since it's a copy, it also has 7 in it. Then I update that copy so this doesn't get affected. So when you return, x is still 7. So I have copied it. So this copy became 0. This is called call by value. I can also do call by reference. So I have x equal to 7, a memory location for x with 7 in it. Here I am sending the address of this x, okay, not a copy or something. And here I am keeping that address with a pointer. So IP points to this address. So when you change it to 0, x is automatically changed as well. So you see x equal to 0 here. It is called call by reference. And this is more efficient Why? Because you avoid the copying of this box to another box here. For integers, it is not a big deal. It is 4 bytes, whatever. But X can be representing an object of a class that's a huge class, like it has megabytes of data in it. Then you need to copy all of them. It is inefficient. But again, there's an issue of losing the in original content, so you need to be careful. Here, I want to swap two numbers, P and Q, but this is the incorrect version because A and B are 3 and 7. I call it regularly, so 3, and here a copy of A comes, which is named P. So whatever I update, whatever update I do to P, it doesn't affect A, so it will still print 3 and 7. Okay, but the correct version will do call by reference in this case. I need it. I want it to operate that way. So A is 3. I sent the address of A, and the pointer P gets it. So P points to the address of A. So whatever you do to P will affect A. So in this scenario, P becomes Q and Q becomes P, the swap logic. So it first becomes 3, 7, and then after swap, A becomes 7. And B becomes 3. Yeah, so this is talking about that. And now I have a new topic, a new variable for C++ about this parameter passing. It is the reference type. In C++, not in C, in C++, references act as an alias to another variable. So how is it useful? Here, Rn. By the way, you need to use this special operator to declare a reference. So Rn is a reference to an integer, and that integer is this guy. So during the declaration, you must give that assignment, okay? It is the rule. So now Rn is an alias for n. So what does it mean? It means that whatever I do to Rn will affect n. So n is 6 now. But now when I make Rn 7, Rn becomes 7, and also n becomes 7. Okay, that is the logic, and m has nothing to do with all these operations, it is 6. So 7, 7, 6 is printed. Now what is happening? I am setting Rn to another integer. So this is not a reference assignment. I can use a number here like 30. Then Rn is 30. And since it is an alias to n, it is also 30, and again m is innocent, it is still 6. But in this scenario, instead of 30, I just use the number 6 through the variable m, so it will print 3 sixes in a row. And with the reference variables, I can still get that call by reference effect, but with a cleaner and a cleaner code. So recall the old version. I need to call it with this and sign, and I need to get it with a pointer. Now I just sent the A, but here P is a reference to an integer, which is A. So P is A, actually. It's an alias to A. So whatever you do to P will affect A. So since it is 3 in the beginning, during this function it becomes 7. So when I return, it will still be 7. This is called reference variable based call by reference. Let's do some exercises. I have a function called fun. So A is sending its address, and the pointer A is keeping that address. So whatever I do to the local A here will affect this A. So what is happening? 3. And by the way, B is call by value. Okay, this is call by reference, this is call by value. So a copy of B is created, and the copy becomes 2. So this will print 2 for the copy, and 2 is here. A was 3, so the new A becomes 5. But when I come back, since it was the copy for B, it will still print 3 because copy got affected. This A, however, was 3 in the beginning, and due to the call by reference action, it becomes 5, right? Here. So that 5 is maintained in the original function where I call the fun one. And another example here, basically I am doing the same call by reference using my reference variable a. So x goes here, a is a alias to x, to an integer which is x. So whatever I do to a will affect x. So x is 3, it becomes 6 now, so it will be 6 in the end. And this 6 is also printed here. I have a C out here. And b is call by value, so y is 5. It gets copied and takes the name of b, it doesn't really matter. And that 5 is printed as, not 5, sorry, because 6 plus 5, that copy becomes 11. So I have 11 print here. And what else? That 5, only the copy got affected, so I have the 5 here. So I have 6, 5 printed. Yes, so far so good, hopefully. I have the class issue. We have discussed this constructor business, etc. Okay. If you recall last week, I skipped this declaration because it has something to do with pointers. So this M1 is an object declaration. All of them are declarations. M1 is an object, an instance of the class incel. And it calls the default constructor, which is this. No, parameter 1 is the default one. So M1.stored value is M1.read will return 0. M2 calls the constructor non-default one with the parameter, one parameter version, this guy. So M2.read will print 8. Now M3. M3 is a pointer to a class called intcell. So just like X is a pointer to type int, M3 is a pointer to class intcell. So I can declare it here, by the way, using my operator called new. So allocate me a new memory of type intcell. And if I leave it like this, it will call the default constructor of it because I don't provide anything, but I can also provide a value like 8 here, then it will call the constructor with one parameter. But let's do the default constructor one. Yeah, so that's it actually. Again, with C connection, you could have written malloc size of int cell and then cast it to int cell with the C. But with C++, it is just one new. Yeah, so this is things we have discussed. And by the way, instead of doing it here during declaration, you can leave it alone here, just like the slide does. And you can make that assignment here. Then it is regular object, but I have this arrow operator, which makes sense because M3 is a pointer, so you can point to the functions offered to you. M3.read, arrow read. But if you are so into the dot notation, you can dereference M3 using our tactic. Now M3. Now this thing, if you see it as a package, so they got connected together. On the left, here is my type. So this is just like M1 and the type. So now I can use the dot read. Yes, I will just write RE. But obviously this one is more popular. It is cleaner notation. So new creates objects of proper size, calls the constructor and returns the pointer as we have seen. Delete destroys the object and calls its destructor. So inside that destructor you can clean up additional memory if that object has allocated more memories for you. So basically new is analogous to malloc and delete is free in C. Let's do more examples. I have pointer 1, which is a pointer to an int cell class. So let's just stick with it now. I create a new int cell. So here I use the constructor with one parameter version, so its value will be 5. And so let's stick with PTR1, then what is happening? So I haven't used it at all, but I can delete it. So it will call the destructor of PTR1 now, inside of which I can delete other allocations. But in this case, I have no further allocations, so only PTR1 is gone. PTR2 is a pointer to an integer, similar logic. And I will call the built-in integer classes constructor with one parameter. So basically, it is setting PTR2 equal to 2. Okay, so we are used to that version. But this version is good to go to the array notation. So let's do the array idea. Let's start with PTR1 again. I want to create 23 objects. So this is a square bracket. 23 objects for the class int cell. Okay, I will not obviously draw all of them. And the initial values are, so there is no specific call with number 6 here, for instance, 6. Then the constructor with 6 will get called, and all the values here will be 6 initially. Okay, but in this scenario, that constructor isn't called, so the default constructor was doing 0 setting, so all the cells will have 0 inside of them initially, 23 of them. So you can reach the third cell, for instance, using PTR1. PTR1 and the square brackets 2, because indices start from 0. So this will land you into this cell. There was 0 in it. Now I want to put number 7 there. So what happens is here I will put 7 for this cell. There is 7 in it now. Same logic, let's do it for integers. Pointer 2 is a pointer to a single integer, but I can make it point to multiple integers using this square bracket tactic again. Here I create 12 blocks, consecutive blocks, each of which is capable of storing one integer. And the initial value of this integer is 0 because the default constructor is called. So zeros, all of them are 0. But let's do non-default constructor like 3, then I have trees in all these slots. Okay, 3, 3, and 3, all of them. And again, with the array logic, I can change the fourth guy to 33 using this thing. Go to the fourth index, which is this, and set it to, let's don't do 33, let's do 4, then it will be 4. And also another thing to notice, PTR2 points to the first element of this block of 12 integers. Okay, so in other words, what I mean is, if you want to access this first block, you do it with the array tactic, the regular tactic, which would give you this thing, which will be obtained using this. Go to the first index, and you can set it to 5, for instance, and this becomes 5. But you can also do it this way. PTR2 is pointing to the first slot, so I can dereference it. Okay, PTR2, dereference it. So now I go to this address, and now I can set it to 52, for instance. So now it becomes 52. Okay, there was 5 years before. Yeah. And then the delete issue. When you do delete new with square brackets, you should also use square brackets during your delete. Yeah, okay. References we have discussed them actually. What is new here? I don't know. Yeah. Reference is just an alias to another variable. I have also done this slide. Okay, skipping. We have discussed the reference issue, but the constant reference is a topic that we haven't discussed yet. So in this case, Rn is a reference to a constant integer, so that integer cannot be changed through Rn then. Okay, if you try to update that content, there will be an error, compile error. By the way, everything that can be done with references can also be done using pointers. But with pointers, the syntax will be uglier. So here, basically, Rn is a reference to an integer, which is the integer given by n. I can also get the same effect. P is a constant pointer to an integer, and here is the address of that integer, again n. So basically, P and Rn are pointing to the same location. So you can either dereference the pointer and update the value of n. Now n is 6 at this point. You can also use the alias of n, which is Rn, and change it. So then this connects to our pointer video that I have shown before. So no need to go there now. So now let's combine pointers, constants, everything all together as nice practices. So here what is happening? P is a constant pointer to an integer, and that integer is I. So I gave the address of I to P. Now, sorry about that. Now, what happened? Yeah, you're here, I guess. Now I can dereference P and set the value to a different value. Weird. And so I has something in it, and now by this statement P points to the address of I, and I dereference P, so I am now in this location, and I put 6 inside of it. So this is okay. What is not okay is the following. P is supposed to be a constant pointer, so you cannot change the state of P. You can change the content where P points, like in the statement, but you cannot tell that, hey P, now go and point to another place, like this memory location, the address of J. Okay, you cannot do this because P is a constant pointer. Another version of it, so be careful, the const is now going to the beginning, I guess. Yes, I is an integer, okay. P is a pointer, a relaxed pointer, so P can change its state, but what P points to is a constant integer. And in this scenario, it is the address of that integer would be the address of I. So if I, so this is the place reserved for I. Yeah, so now I can dereference P as usual, but if I can read this content, if I have 7 here, I can read it as 7. But if I try to update it, then it's not okay, because I is treated as a constant when accessed through P. But I can still update it using I equal to something, because I itself isn't constant. It's also possible to declare a constant pointer to a constant value. So P is a constant pointer to a constant value. In this case, since it's a pointer, I need an address of an integer, which is a constant integer, phi n in this case. Parameter passing, we have done this just previously, called by reference. Okay, here I will show you an addition to the call by reference using the reference variable. So what is that? Pass by value. Recall what is happening here. This is the regular function call. You just sent the parameter and you expect it without any operator or something, a regular case. So what happens here is a copy of x is created, and that copy comes in here as a, and then I double square a, and then I return the new a. Okay, there is a little mistake here, I guess. Return a. So what happens in this scenario is if 2 is it 2? Yes, x is 2. 2 comes here, it becomes 4 locally, the copy is updated, and I return 4. So r1 becomes 4. It will print 4 here. However, x, the copy of x got updated here, hence x is still 2. So this is call by value. So some copying has happened here. This is inefficient, not so good. I mean, it's not terrible, obviously. Sometimes it's okay, and usually we do call by value anyway, but there is some copying involved here. You should be aware of that. Now I will square by reference tactic, which is the following. I send the variable like regularly, but on the square by reference function here, I expect a reference to an integer, and that integer is in this case z. So cref is now a reference to z, so whatever I do to cref will affect the z, the colors argument. So z becomes, it was 4 before the call, here it, after here, now here it is 16. So I print 16 here. Now the const reference thing, so this can be a problem. Sometimes it's a feature, it is not a bug, it's a feature, but sometimes it's a problem. So the problematic part is the following. The z value here has gone to a function, it's played something there, and when it comes back, the original value is lost. So this may not be desired at all times. So by using const reference, you guarantee that that z value or whatever, that value has not been updated in that function. So let's see how it happens. So x is 2, I send x to this function. Now be careful, it is the same as this. So a is an alias to x, but be careful, it is going to treat x as constant. So if you try to update that x through a, its reference, its alias, there will be a compile error. So what happened then? I couldn't do call by reference, but I have done the following. I avoid the copying. Recall, in the first example, I have x, and I have a, so this is the slot for x, and here I copy x, so x value was 2, I copy that value 2 into a different location, so I have two boxes here. And the good news is the original x has not been affected, so I have still printed 2 here. But now with constant reference, again, the origin value will not be affected, and I will avoid the copying. So what happened is the 2, the x comes here, a is a reference to that x, so a is here, and I cannot update x because I will get a compile error. So I do something with that x, not that I avoid the copying again, I cross it again. So I return it back as 4. So r2 becomes 4. Wonderful. And x is still 2. So what happened is I avoided the copying, and I also avoided the side effects using const and reference. So let's see another example on that. I will improve my complex class with that logic. This is the old version. Here I expect an object of class complex. So this is a larger class, larger than a regular integer. So here I was dealing with a plain integer, so it is not a big deal. But when you are dealing with big objects, it matters. So I want to do a call by reference here. So I can do the call by reference, but by this tactic, our right hand side becomes an alias to the argument, but I will also add this const here so that I will never try to update the values of right hand side, hence the argument. So here is the function. I assure you that within this function, you will never see a statement, an assignment statement like this. Go to a member of right-hand side. You can read it. It is read-only, obviously. It's data. But you cannot update it. So thanks to this const, you avoid that side effect. You ensure that nothing will be updated in the color domain. You also, with the reference tactic, you ensure that no copying occurs, so it's efficient. Yeah, it is that. So what is this constant, by the way? It is irrelevant of parameter passing. This says that this function will not update the state of this object, of its member. So what is the plain and naked member, RE? So I cannot do RE equal to 6 here because of this red const. And this purple const avoids, disallows our right-hand side dot RE update. Okay, so let's wrap it up. We may encounter consts in the following cases. I will send a constant reference parameter. So right hand side is a reference, but it's a constant, so it ensures that nothing gets modified on this parameter. I can also do a constant member function, which guarantees that this function cannot modify the class members. And I can also have a constant object or constant variable, which guarantees that you can't update its state. So you cannot do C1 equal to C2, for instance, because C1 is supposed to be constant. Okay, memory management. We have discussed this a little bit. Let's see what is new. At least let's repeat. It's a different example. So PI is a pointer to an integer, so it needs to allocate a new memory that is able to hold one integer, and that content of that integer is 6. If you want to allocate memory for 3 integers, then you need to put square brackets 3 here, and then you can follow it by the parameter, the initial value, which is 6. Then you will get 3 guys which all have 6 as the content in the beginning, and PI points to the first guy at all times. Pointer to a complex, PC is a pointer to a complex number. Again, the same logic. Give me a memory location, a new location, memory for one complex number whose content is 3, 5. So 3 plus 5i, real part, imaginary part. And once you are done with them, you will delete whatever you have nuked. In this case, PI and PC. Okay. So this looks like my array example here. 3 integer blocks. Here I want 10 complex blocks. Okay. And I can access each of them using this square brackets operator again. So this gives me the ith block, ith slot, and I call the print on that object. And then once I am done, I delete them with the square brackets because I have used square brackets during the new part. Yeah, so same for the integer. Default argumenting revisited, because I have visited this issue last week. Basically, if your function is like this, if you provide nothing, then all defaults will be x equal to 1 and y equal to 2. So it means inside this function, if you, print x, it will print 1. But if you have called that function using this, then 5 will overwrite. So you overwrite from left to right, okay? So 5 comes to the place of x, so it will print 5 for x. And y will be 2, z will be 3. In this case, x 5, y 8, z 3. In this case, x 5, y 8, z 9. So, but if you want to specify a value for z and use the defaults for x and y, it is impossible to do it in this configuration. Okay, because you need to go to the right hand side by skipping the left guys. Remember, I read from left to right, so you can't do that. If you really want that, you need to put int set as the first one, so you need a parameter here like 9, and then you leave the others alone. In that case, they will get the defaults of 1 and 2. Function overloading, again revisit, we have discussed this. Square, same function name with different parameters. Either types are different, or numbers of parameters are different, or both of them are different. So they got overloaded. Functions that only differ by return type cannot be overloaded. Okay, so the parameters must be different. Okay, not the return type, it doesn't really matter. We have seen operator overloading in the previous minutes. So in particular, I have overloaded this operator, but there are all these operators that can be overloaded, and no one else can be overloaded. Okay, only the existing operators can be overloaded. Yes. Now comes the constructor. We can talk more about constructors. We have this special copy constructor, which is responsible for creating copies of objects of that class. So what do I mean by that? When does this occur? When the user explicitly requests a copy of an object, like C1 equal to C2 case, or when the object is passed by value. Recall, we have passed by value, passed by reference, passed by constant reference. If you do passed by value, then a copy of it is constructed. Then this copy constructor will get called. And also when a function returns an object by value. So these are related. So here, this is a copy constructor. Why? Because it expects an object of the same class, and then it assigns the values of it to my own values. Copy C values to this values, to this dot re. We also have this keyword later. So here, this is not a copy constructor, because this is just a constructor that takes some arguments useful during the initialization of my string. But this is a copy constructor, because the argument is the class itself. It's an object from the same class, so I will copy the S content to this content. So let's see how it works. S has a length. I set my length, or this length, this dot length. So we usually don't use the keyword this here, but it is implied. There is always this dot length is equal to s dot length. This dot str, I allocate space for this many characters, and then I can use the C function, because recall C++ is a superset. I can use str copy, or you can just do a regular for loop from 0 to length plus 1. The last guy is the null terminator, if you recall. Yeah, so I basically copy all the stuff in S to this object. So let's see how are they called. Here the default constructor is called, recall no parameter case. Here the copy constructor is called, the thing we are discussing for the previous couple of minutes. B becomes A, basically. A gets copied into B. Here, this is the same as calling BBA. So this thing, because copy constructor is called, but I am now using the assignment explicitly. Here, default constructor, and here, the assignment operator calls the copy constructor. So, assignment operator, I will overload equal sign to implement my assignment operator, in which I do this shallow copy. Everything in my object will go to my object one. And this is a special pointer that I have kind of introduced here. It is useful at some point, so let's see. Each class object has a pointer which automatically points to itself. Okay, it is useful to return yourself to the outer world. We will see an example of it. So, or it's also useful for this purpose. I will overload the equality sign. Okay, so I am implementing my assignment operator for a complex number. So a right-hand side comes. First of all, if the user is drunk or something and tries to execute this statement, C1 is equal to C1. So assign C1 to C1. It is quite redundant. So this is C1 because it calls operator recall. This unfolds into this function call C1.operator equal and call it with C1. Okay. So this is C1 and this is also C1. So if this is equal to the right hand side, which is C1 in this case, then I do nothing. So there may be millions lines of codes here. I avoid them using this pointer. It is useful here, as you can see. So I avoid statements like this. I mean, I don't avoid. If you are drunk, you can still write it, but I don't spend time to execute the if block for this stupid statement. And so assume that a regular person has written this assignment, which is very acceptable, which is expected. See, let's copy, let's assign C2 to C1. So C1 will be C2. So this is C2 now. C1 isn't equal to C2. It is different. So what happens is C1.re, this re becomes C2.re. Okay. Similarly, this imaginary becomes C2.imaginary. And then another feature of this is the following. I can enable concatenation. So maybe this is the statement. Okay. So I execute from right to left. C2 becomes C3. Okay. And then that this new C2 is C3 now. I return it. So I return it back as C3. So now sorry, C2 is returned, but the content of C3. So since I return it, I can concatenate another assignment operation. Okay, so these are the two important usages of this pointer. Here is another assignment operator. Okay, so previous was about complex numbers. This is about strings. Again, if this right-hand side is the same as this string, I skip, just return the string itself, which has not changed anyway. Otherwise, I delete the existing string to save memory. Then I set the length to the right-hand side length, and I set the content to the right-hand side content. Okay, my default constructor, as we discussed, expects no parameters. Copy constructor expects one parameter, which is of the same class type. And the assignment operator, again, it expects the same class type object and assigns the content of A to this object. Here the constructor is called, default constructor is called. Here the copy constructor is called. And here the assignment operator is done. Destructor stuff with pointers, for classes with pointers, we also need destructors to avoid useless memory in our system. If it is useless, we should give it back to the system. Destructors are the places where we do that. So in this scenario, the only memory consuming thing is this str pointer, which will get some new at some point during implementation. So in the destructor, that new should be disabled using delete. Recall the destructor is called automatically when the scope of that object finishes. I have discussed this issue in serious detail in our previous lecture, previous week. Yeah, so this is not a quite important rule, actually. It's telling you that destructor, constructor, and assignment operator are there. And static members, again, we have discussed static stuff in the previous week. Here we will tell you something more about the static members. Mainly, I want to tell you this. Normally, when you have static values, static members are shared by all objects of a class. Normally, when you declare one object, C1, it has its own copy of this RE real variable, integer variable, okay? When you have C2, it has its own copy. Okay, so when you update the RE of C2, C1 doesn't get affected because they are not shared. But if you have defined RE as static, then an update here will be affecting the other objects as well. So what do I mean by that? What is meant is the following. So count is a static variable which is defined by just putting static keyword in front of it. So here, by making count static, I will be using only one count throughout the objects. They will be shared. So it is useful to count the number of objects, for instance. Its main usage is that. So this is the way we initialize and we access the static variables using two colons. This function will return that. So here, for instance, I have a new C1. So this increases count to 1. Okay, initially it is 0 because. And this C1 has a real number of 7 and imaginary number of, sorry, real number of 0 and imaginary number of 0. Then later, I have C2 created. C2 changes the state of this count, so it becomes 2 now. So see, I am basically counting the number of objects. I have 2 objects in my hand at this time. However, its real is a different 0 and its imaginary is a different 0. Okay, so when I update c2.re to 10, this becomes 10, but this stays 0. So here it prints 0 initially, then I declare a new object c1, this get count will print 1, then I declare another complex number c2, and if I do another print get count here, c2.getCount, so you can call it over anywhere, it will give you number 2. Also, you can call it, since it's a static value, you can also call it using this notation. Name of the class followed by 2 columns. And now comes the final and last but not least, I should say, because this is also super important. You should pay attention here as well. Template programming. So this is about creating a design. Okay, so this you are creating, giving the design of your function or class, and it will be associated with types during the execution. Okay, so that is the idea. Let me begin with function templates. So a function template is not an actual function, it's a design of a function, just like I said. So the way, and then the compiler creates the actual function during runtime based on the types used in the program. Okay, so here is the template function. You begin with template keyword followed by the less than sign and then the class keyword, and here is your placeholder. It can be anything, usually it is T, and then you have this greater sign to close it. Then you write your function, but be careful, I use T here, the placeholder. Later I may want to swap integers, then T will be associated with integer. So this is the pattern here. And it doesn't depend on the type, right? You can swap 2 complex numbers, maybe. You can swap 2 floats, maybe. They are all possible. So that's why it's very powerful. And this doesn't exist in C, by the way. It's a C++ feature. So the way I make the instantiation is like this. X is 5, X, Y is 7. So this is X. So when I call swap over integer parameters, then compiler instantiates, creates the int version of that design. And later, if I call it with another integers, I don't re-instantiate because it has already been created. That design has been made into an actual function. So I use the same instantiation. So what happens is x57, after this call by reference, be careful, this is call by reference, we have studied this. X becomes 7, Y becomes 5, and after this call, they swap again. So here, X in the end, X is 5, and Y is 7. Here, I call the same design using a different parameter type. So compiler creates another actual function based on floats. And it uses 2 and 4, it swaps them, so it will print 4 and 2 in the end. And if you try to do this thing, which sends two different types, int and float, but here I expect only one type, t and t, so it will be an error. Same logic, I can extend it to classes. Here is a class called template test. I begin with the template and this less than sign followed by class and the placeholder. So in this case, again, I provide you the design of the class, not the actual class. The actual class will be created during runtime by the types involved. So in this test case, maybe if t is integer, this function expects an integer and returns an integer. It keeps some integer values, etc. And this is the interface, by the way, .h file. Implementation file goes with the same logic, the name of the class and two colon tactic. Now I also need to put this T with the opener and closer, and I should also remember to put this line above the function of this class. And now comes the interesting part, how to put this in action. So here, let's fill our header file, the interface file, with the placeholder t. So previously I have used int cell, right, to simulate integer cell. Now it will be any cell of type t. It can still be integer, obviously. This is my constructor, this is my function, and this is my stored value of type t. Now, that was the interface. Here is the implementation. Like read of it will return stored value. As you can see, it doesn't really depend on t. This is the design. Now it makes all sense with this driver program where I tell that t is an integer. So now the memory cell is going to be an integer memory cell. Instantiate an integer version. And later I may declare another object with integer. So I don't re-instantiate because it has already been created. I use the previous instantiation. And here I have a float real number cell, which is okay. So for the real number case, I will send real numbers to their function. And for the integer cases, I will send integers and they will act accordingly. So this is the wonderful idea of template programming. Friend functions, we have discussed them actually. So this dummy is going to be a function that will be in another class that will be implemented outside of this class complex, but I still want dummy to access the private members of complex. So complex announces dummy as its friend, as its close friend, so it can access its private parts as well. Not a close friend, obviously, just a friend. So the dummy here, it is defined somewhere. So it is defined in this main function, for instance. It is called from the main function. It is defined in this other file, the file that is not the complex file at all. But see, I can go and get the private parts of one, the complex number, since dummy is my friend, is complex's friend. With the same logic, I can define other functions. So operator overloading is basically a function, right? So the same idea, I can, since this is the friend function, it can still access the private part. So I'm skipping this. Yes. Recap of friendship. We have class B that declares A as its friend. So within the class A, I can now access the private parts of B, which is I. So B.I is possible thanks to the friendship. And finally, we close the C++ crash course adventure with the error handling mechanism. In C, it is quite primitive. You return error codes like numbers, and you do something based on these numbers. In C++, we have a more principled way of handling errors. We basically try a block that potentially leads to errors or exceptions. We throw exceptions and we catch them. So, and the good news is you can throw not only integer error codes, but you can throw any object here. So in this case, I am throwing a string object. So I try this function read, which has a potential to throw something. Okay, and you must follow the try block with the catch block. So whatever you are throwing, you know it. So in this case, I am throwing a string. So I am ready to catch a string and then do something with that message. Yeah. So here is that principled thing I am talking about. I can throw an object of this class. So with the default constructor of it. And here I catch that object and then I get more information used from that object. And also one little thing about the this error handling mechanism, the destructors of the local objects will be called when an exception is thrown. Okay, so I have a local object here, A. Okay, A is an object of class big A. So it is an object, okay, the constructor of it is called here, and maybe later here I have other memory allocations due to A. But when I throw something, the destructor of that local object is called. So it is like I am, the scope of A is finishing here. So throw makes that possible for you as well. And again, not only one type can be thrown. So during this block, I can throw an integer exception. I can throw a string exception. So I can also throw a customized type exception. So I need to be ready to catch all of them. And so I said handling exceptions was the last thing, but this is really the last thing, because STL has a special part in my heart. I recall that, and it in all the C++ lovers' hearts actually, because it is very useful. It provides you, among all these things, the most important is the containers. It provides you data structures like linked lists, queues, stacks, hash maps, sets, and dynamic arrays. So we will be implementing them anyway in this course. We will learn how they operate. But still, as a programmer, as a computer scientist, or as another related person, you don't really want to implement everything from scratch. Obviously, this course is important. Don't get me wrong. You know how they get implemented. But The other part of this class is the usage of them in the right context. So that data structures come to you through the STL library as well. So in this case, we will focus on the vector, the dynamic array part, which can update its size automatically, grow and shrink. And also this is a good test case for the template programming. Here vector is a design of code. Here I want a vector of integers called a, and I want four elements in the beginning. So it is not so common because it is dynamic growing anyway. You don't have to start with a number, but if you start with four elements, you can also set initial values of them, like trees, and again they will be holding integers at each entry. Here is your C, it will be holding an integer as well, but you can also hold a complex number here, or salary here, or animal object here, anything. So the idea of template programming just works fine here. And with that vector, within that vector class, we also have operator overloading. So another test case, use case here. You can access the third number or any number using that operator called close brackets. And you can go to the third element of that vector A using the index 2, and then you can update it, or you can just read it. You can get the size of that container, you can assign that container to another one, and you can insert stuff using pushback. So let's go over this example. I push back 3, so 3 will be my first element, index 0, then I put 2, which will be my second element. So v0 is this, v1 is this, okay. V size is 2, I have 2 guys. So normally we don't do this popback a lot. You can access any element anyway, but in this scenario, popback just removes the last element. This is similar to the stack logic. So now my v size is 1, so v size minus 1 is 0. Go to v0, which is this, and get it basically, and assign it to t, so t becomes 3, and then remove this v as well. So now I have an empty container, empty vector. Yeah, okay. This suddenly finishes our course, but we have discussed quite a bit on C++, so let's not repeat them all in the end, but you should be very good at all the things that I have discussed today as well as the previous week. And this finishes our C++ business crash course on that. So I highly recommend you to go and take a look at other tutorials to solve more problems. Learn CPP was something I have recommended, but obviously there are many more. Yeah, so and next week we will begin with a theoretical topic, which is the algorithm analysis, the complexity analysis. So things will get more exciting as we proceed. Then we will go to the data structures. So hold on. All right. Good day.